Welcome to everybody. Thank you for your patience in joining us today. And I'm so, so pleased that you've been able to join us today as we start our penultimate panel session. My name is June Reid, and I'm pleased to welcome you to today's session of Sound System Outernational Number 7, Sound System at the Crossroads. Just to say a little bit about Sound System Outernational, aka SSO. Sound System Outernational is an ongoing initiative of practitioners and researchers in association with Goldsmiths University of London, and it's dedicated to recognising, stimulating and supporting sound system culture worldwide. Since 2016, Sound System Outernational has created spaces for dance and discussion by organising events and curating publications to bring together practitioners and researchers of sound system culture worldwide, fostering intergenerational conversations to strengthen the culture and to explore its technologies, aesthetics, and politics. Just to say a little bit about Sonic Street Technologies, SST. They are the partner organization for SSO number 7, Sound System International 7. And it's an ERC-funded research project launched in 2021, examining the culture, diaspora, and knowledge of subaltern and global south uses of sound technologies. In addition to lectures and panel, Sound System International features exclusive sound system performances from sounds around the world and a number of related feature film screenings and short movies. Our film program is available at our link tree and on all our socials, while the performances will be premiered on our YouTube channel. So today's panel is entitled Space, Place and Belonging, Sonic Imagination and Essential Creative Practices. The format for today's panel will follow the same layout as our earlier panels. Our guests will speak for a maximum of 15 minutes each, and I will introduce each panel and allow them to make their presentation. After that, they will address a few questions that you can type in our Q&A box, and we welcome loads of questions. And that's Q&A box is at the bottom of your screen. Please remember to state clearly which speaker your question is addressed to. Our team will pick them up as many questions as possible, or we will field them to our panelists. Please type your question in the Q&A box at any time during the session. The session is also being streamed live to our YouTube channel. So now I will briefly introduce today's esteemed panelists, and it's an honor to be introducing them, some of whom I've had the pleasure of meeting personally, virtually, and I hope to meet others subsequently. So we're going to start with Micheal McMillan. Known Michael for a very long time, he is a playwright, artist, curator, and educator. As an academic, he focuses his research on the creative process, ethnography, oral histories, material culture, and performativity. He is the author of several plays, and as an artist, is best known for his first installation, The West Indian Front Room, which was exhibited with great success in 2005, attracting more than 35,000 visitors in its initial outing at the Jeffrey Museum, and went on to inspire a BBC4 documentary called Tales from the Front Room, 2007, a website, and a 2009 book. Next, we have Thali Lotus, BA, MSc, who is the founder of Kaya, Come As You Are, which is an audio enterprise and sound system. Thali was born in London into a sound system household. It has always been musical vibrations and frequency that has been prominent in her life, constantly steering and the direction that it takes. Having attended the Brit Performing Arts School together with an array of other musical experiences, she founded Kaya Sound System Enterprise in 2016. Now, Kaya Sound System is one of a handful of female-led sound systems in particularly London and possibly throughout the UK. And she has proudly collaborated with a range of organisations. Moving to Njelle W. Hamilton, she is an Associate Professor of English and American Studies at the University of Virginia. She specialises in contemporary Caribbean literary and cultural studies. Njelle is the author of Photographic Memories, Popular Music, and the Contemporary Caribbean Novel, 2019. Her essays on sound studies, trauma theory, and the physics of time have appeared in a number of journals, and her short fiction has been published in pre-Caribbean writing. Her current book project, tentatively titled The Physics of Caribbean Time, reads recent time travel novels through the lens of physics and the Caribbean theory. Next will be Christine Hannigan, who's a PhD candidate from the United States, and she expects to complete her PhD in 2024 at UCL. She's learning how culture is commodified to promote urban regeneration schemes and comparing that with how existing local culture develops. Her overlapping interests include housing and the privatization and financialization of urban infrastructure and space. Outside academia, Christine plays tennis sax amongst friends and writes freelance mostly about music. And last but not least is Melvin Cook, who lectures in the Bachelor of the Arts Communication Arts and Technology program at the School of Humanities and Social Sciences and at UTEC in Jamaica. He's a PhD candidate in the Institute of Cultural Studies at the University of West Indies, Mona, deepening a research interest in communication utilising Jamaica popular music, which began his MPhil, completed in the ICS. So I'd like to welcome you to our first speaker, Micheal McMillan from the University of the Arts, whose paper is entitled Sonic Vibrations, Sound System Culture, Lovers, Rock and Dub. Handing over to you, Micheal.
Sound vibration. This language of dub could be bodies mapping memory.
Hi, good evening, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for the, and it's an honor to be here. Before I start, I just want to kind of give thanks to my ancestors for bringing me here and for those who are present and all those who are future. In the allotted time, and I hope I can meet that in 15 minutes, I'm going to be talking about an anthology I've been bringing together called Sonic Vibration, Sound System, Lovers, Rock and Dub. Before that, I would actually say that for Cornel West, Black music is the most powerful gift we have given to human culture, because against the backdrop of racial catastrophe, we have created a universal language that soothes the mind, body and soul with sweetness, love and freedom. Now, Sonic Vibrations, the e-anthology, will be launched on the 15th of September this year in two parts. It's actually a massive e-anthology, and it brings together really a set of practitioners, sound artists, sound system practitioners, sound and visual artists, choreographers, scholars, poets, and writers who, as fellow travelers, have contributed essays, short stories, oral history, testimonies, commentaries, and poetry. And these have been read and performed live as audio podcasts alongside the online texts. And this is an example here from Writers Mosaic. Writers Mosaic is an initiative led by writers of color that is accessible now, and it's under the auspices of the Royal Literary Fund, of which I am a member. And so this body of work integrates a discursive insights, alternative knowledge, and creative interventions about the lived experience, the sonic vibrations and technologies of an often overlooked area of Black, British, and diasporic culture. Sonic Vibrations also draws on our rockers, soul hits and lovers, sound systems back in the day, an installation-based exhibition that I curated in collaboration with Dub Morphology in 2016. The title alludes to the science, music cultures of the Black, ravers during the 70s, in which I was a part as a rocker and follower of dub sound systems like Shaka. And then you have the soulheads who went to soul clubs around London, London by Lyceum, Global Village, Gossips and Crackers. And then there was Lovers Rock. It's important to mention that sound is not simply a product, it's also a process. It's a sounding, to kind of pick up the term from Julian Henricus. Loi Shote Soke, and here I'm sharing you images of some of the contributors, through Sonic Vibrations. In his fascinating anthology, this anthology, Dr. Satan's Echo Chamber, Sode Soke meditates on the relationship between race, the machine, and technology. And I need to thank her sound system, Outernational, because it was at the, I think, the fifth or sixth iteration in Naples that I met Louis, actually. And then from there, we've just been connected. So for Shote Soke, the Enlightenment, he argues, was effectively a crisis in Western identity about what it meant to be human in response to the replacement of people by machines for industrialization. The slave plantation was the first machine, and some slaves like machines were considered to lack a soul. A crisis of disembodiment and loss of selfhood, which remains at the root of cybernetic theory and cybernetics. The only machine technology that Black people had access to was sound recording, which spoke to the future in what Shoke Soke calls Black techno-poetics. The nexus of Black and technology is fused through sound. Now, if we think about the kind of post-human nature, for instance, of dub, that speaks to the future and speaks in sonic vibrations through the oral testimony of dub morphology, which is Gary, Stuart, and this thing going up doing its own thing. We're not going on it. And Gary Stuart and Trevor Matteson. And they, in their oral testimony, they share their music and sonic heritage that informed the development of their international practice as sonic and video artists. And from a stream of running water, the dissonant crackle of a vinyl record, the cacophony of a party, sound bites of politicians, they use sonic technology to experiment, following in the pioneer tradition of Black avant-garde musicians and producers such as Lee Scratch Perry, George Clinton, and Sun Ra. Now, through the lens of a young boy, Courtier Newlyn, the novelist, his piece called Natal recalls his father's dressing up and growing up ritual. The smell of aftershave, fresh white shirt, crisp slacks, gleaming shoes, and an afro pick passing through his hair. The mother and father take him and his brother by car to a blues party. And as he follows his parents into the blues, the sensation of darkness, smell of curry goat and ganja, and the elemental force of the bass become the grounding on which he builds his culture as a Black person growing up and living in the UK. Raven always requires meticulous preparation, and this is kind of alluded to by Courtier, and includes the finding of the exclusive outfit and accessories to match, along with the grooming rituals like visit to the barbers and hairdressers. And in thinking of this, Courtier Newlands, he actually was one of the co-scriptors for Steve McQueen's Lover's Rock, and where you find in a sense that Black bodies are always on view, so they might as well give something to gaze at. In this idea of kind of like Black leisure institutions, which Paul Gilroy kind of coins, we have house parties that, you know, took place in the front room, blues parties and shebeens. And a memory here that I take one of the oral pieces from Raucous Holeheads and Lovers, Veronica Barnes remembers the police arriving at a blues party after the neighbors complaining about the loud music. The funniest thing, quote, the funniest thing is that when the police come to tell us to turn down the music, the women would give them some curry goat and they would turn red because they weren't used to the pepper. Then the women would take the police hat, put it on their head and wind up with them. actually it was often black women who managed black parties, where they sold cooked food to supplement their incomes as well as financially supporting their spouse's passion for sound systems. And, you know, in my, where I live now in Hackney, the manor, we have a whole history of clubs from all nations, QBs, Phoebes, Mingles, Duggies, Night Moves, Club Norwich. And at Four Aces, Mick Jagger hang out, Bob Marley, I think even Bob Dylan actually, and Stevie Wonder, and Jimmy Cliff performed. There is actually a really great film called Legacy in the Dust about the Four Aces story. Now, H. Patton's evocative essay, Dance in Identity in a Strange Land, Visibility and Symbolism, picks up this idea of dancing culture within the Black British communities. And he uses King Alpha's song as a metaphor for exploring how neo-African bodies in the Africa diaspora have used dance as embodied resistance to oppression. His commentary is interspersed with detailed descriptions of dance moves and styles that would be seen on the dance floor in blues parties, clubs, and sound system dances. Now, in the kind of one of the next areas that in this anthology, Sonic Vibrations, is referring to the dance floor, as it were, and what takes place. And significant within that is Lover's Rock. Now, some of you may know, reggae has always had love songs, Dennis Brown, Gregory Isaacs, Alton Ellis, etc. But then we have emerging in the 1970s, a particular Black British reggae genre, which is reggae, Lover's Rock. And the late Menelik Shabazz's film, The Story is Lover's Rock, captures, in a sense, the erotics of the dance floor. And Heather Dolphin, also from Rockers, Soulheads and Lovers, remembers, quote, "There were codes about where you dance in a party. Someone would be eyeing you up, and the next thing you're dancing beside, they're beside it asking you for a dance. If they couldn't dance, then you'll signal to your friends to avoid them, and then will disappear to the toilets," end of quote. Now, Black women's absence and presence in the sound system space is interrogated in a five-person woman, Black woman conversation. And these are the women involved in that, called Sisters in Sound: Sonia Boyce, Carol Lehman, Yasmin Foster, Denise Noble, and Lisa Palmer. They look critically at patriarchy and misogyny in the dancehall space, sound system culture, and Lover's Rock, with a focused exploration of Susan Godogan's iconic 1975 tune, Hurts So Good, where we pick up how women dress, waiting to be asked for a dance, when a tune is played in the dance space, and the pain and pleasure of lyrics in Godogan's high-pitched vocal performance. And in a sense, the way that Lover's Rock, the women all have high-pitched sounds in their voices rather than lower registers in their voice. And then the next stage in terms of kind of bringing the kind of Black female presence within sound system, we have a number of sound system practitioners, and I'm moving on to this slide now. We have Sister Culture, and she was one of the first led female sound systems in this country. Because in a sense, sound system is seen often as a kind of male domain of boys playing with sonic toys, and is really being this challenged and disruptive by women's creative agencies of DJs and MCs. Also their sound engineering knowledge and practice in recording studios and the operation of their own sound systems. This includes Valerie Robinson, aka Lady V, who was the first woman to manage a sound system, V Rocket in Nottingham. DJs like Rankin Merva, Elaine Smith, DJ Elaine, Lorna G, and of course, Sister Culture. And then we have, and June is here. We have also Nzinga, which is led by Linda Rosenior Patton, aka DJ Ade, and June Reid as Junie Rankin, which is Nzinga Sounds. this theme of kind of black female presence, absence within sound system culture is further developed in Denise Noble's essay, Gimme That Touch, Couple Dance in an Erotic Gender Politics of Reggae. In a sense, a critique of the complex gender and social sexual politics in reggae dancehall across the African diaspora. She sees complex emotional attachments and non-erotic love amongst men as a form of homo latency, which absents Black women. Black women's presence has now become an increasingly signified by dance styles that emphasize a form of commodified Black hypersexuality for a younger generation who have no interest in this close couple dancing of Lover's Rock. Now, as the first woman to lead a sound system, Donna Moore, in her oral history, she remembers both the traditional and modern music cultures who grew up in Guyana and then Britain, and how these shaped her practice as a sound woman. Sister culture emerged in the area of reggae dancehall, which became notorious for its misogynist and homophobic lyrics, and which she challenged with her own counter lyrics. She would also share this ethical approach to making music in DJ workshops with young people. And as I mentioned earlier, you have Nzinga. Now, what's significant about Nzinga is their openness to playing anything from Rod Stewart to Baba Mal, and reflected their eclectic music culture they grew up with in Jamaica and Sierra Leonean immigrant households, and the taste they acquired playing at family gatherings. Their in-depth knowledge of African music and political activism made sound systems' cliched playlist more inclusive and challenged its patriarchal culture. Now, keeping in the family, as it were, sound system practice has always been passed on to the next generation. Young warrior, the son of Jashaka, a case in point. And this is also for Jan Zimmern Foster's stories in her piece, A Thousand Volts of Lullabies, about how she and her sisters established their own sound, Legs 11. After inheriting their father's record collection built up when he was selector on his own sound, John 90 High Power. She also remembers the music on tape cassettes that her mother played as sound sonic lullabies to send her to sleep, which would resurface in later years. And then we have, as I mentioned, the dub poetry, which is Khadija. And the clip you heard, sound clip you heard earlier, was from Khadija's sound vibration. We have also the glorious Jean Bintabreeze and Litai Tafari. So their poetry, like what you heard, as is audio, but it's also being have a soundscape created by dub morphology and original.
So to cut in there, Michael, because you've been an amazing presentation, but you literally got
time.
You're coming up to, in fact, you're 1 minute over. Can you briefly sum up?
The final piece is Micheal Kalada Ache, who talks about, in his piece Beyond Days of Fasting, about Wizkid and Afrobeat. And then we also have Franklin Rogers, whose photographic piece is a series of 13 images from the Vox, which was a jazz funk club in the 1980s, 1990s. Because sound system is always seen as reggae, but you know, sound system is also funk as well. That is I and I, give thanks and praises.
Yeah, give thanks there, Michael. Very, very interesting paper covering a number of issues, and I'm sure you'll get loads of questions at the end of our panelists' contribution. So I'm now moving over to Thali, as I said earlier. Thali runs and owns Kaya Sound System based in Bedford, UK. And Thali's paper is entitled Sound Never Dies, It Just Renews. Handing over to you, Thali.
Thank you. I'm just going to, can everyone see that? Sorry, one moment. Okay, greetings. greetings. It is a great pleasure to be here as part of SS Part 7. I've been very much involved in Sound System Outernational for many years now, I think from 2016. And I just really wanted to describe what's happening currently, and also to give some feedback and also to share what the experience has been like. I think it's quite poignant that I'm actually part of this panel, which is place, space and belonging, just because of what's happening currently in the world. And obviously the title of this Outernational series is Sound System at Crossroads. I myself, as you know, I'm Thali Lotus, and I am the founder of Kaya Sound System, which stands for Come As You Are, which was established in 2016. So I was actually became part of Outernational. I think I was at the 2016 edition and have been involved ever since. But Kaya Sound System was born in 2016 and has been predominantly a sound and root sound system, which is engineered and was designed and partly built by myself, and has been very, very privileged to have collaborated and taken part in some really monumental events and been able to really demonstrate, you know, sound system in this modern time, as well as, you know, from a female perspective. So it's definitely been a journey thus far, very, very fun filled, but also I think quite significant in what I've learnt and what I'm currently, and the sound is currently going through, which is a transition. So as I said, it's quite apt that this series is called Sound System at a Crossroad, just because Kaya is at a crossroad in the sense of it, you know, transitioning from a sound system now into, you know, an audio business. So it's very exciting, very, very exciting. And yes, I'm going to share a piece entitled Sound Never Dies, It's Just Renewed. Just because I think why I've titled it this, I write generally as part of my background in academia. But I wrote this more so because, as I said, of it being quite timely, what's currently going on. But I think it's also important to document how sound system is being affected, how the culture is being affected, and what effect it's actually happened, it's having on sound system founders. So yes, this is Sound Never Dies, It's Just Renewed. One moment, oh, I didn't want to do that. I don't know if I can, one moment. I don't want to stop share. I just need to. Oh, I don't want to stop share. Right, what I need to do. Sorry, I'm just trying to get my piece up so that I can actually. Oh, no, no. Stop share. Let's do that. I think that's going to be the easiest thing. There we go. Okay. So as I said, sound never dies, it's just renewed. The Kaya X3E crossroad plan. So I am, you are, we are vibrational transducers, constantly transforming energy from the lowest infrasonic waves as our hearts beat and we feel emotions to the most supreme frequency of tweeters. Sound has simply reproduced what we are, in the same way that the sustainable city in Dubai is currently recharging. As a huge weight of reinforced diaphragms, the audio drivers meet the regular motion of musical tones, so is vibration infused orderly and spiritually. The disturbance of equilibrium allows molecules to transmit sounds to the air and as such erupt both electrically and neurologically over the liquid canvas that is the human body. Independent of external stimuli, the body alone creates vibration and requires little to attain such an experience. Traveling faster through us than it does through air, vibrations travel via a pathway of neurons in the auditory cortex of the brain, which then fires electrical impulses triggered first by sound, allowing us to experience music. There is no one without the other. Now, in the same way that sound travels and disperses in our body, so it does through musical instruments and speakers. Noting the great rise of vibrational speakers, we see how technology attempts to replicate what the human body does naturally. As not only are we able to hear, see, and touch sound, we reproduce it. Our voice and vocal cords work in synergy to create sound and effortlessly transfer it from one energy type to another. And it is with this same energy and recurrent energy that we ourselves become renewable. Like an atom to an organism, sound and everything that it applies itself to, such as people, sound system, language, etc., become renewed and live on. And it is from this perspective and vein that I would like to relate this piece. Sound as described as sound is described as naturally produced, but with the advancement of technology, it is amplified. So I'll just read that again. Sound as described as is naturally produced, but with the advancement of technology, it is amplified. This partnership is best demonstrated through mic technology and loudspeakers. Just imagine if everything was limited to us, our bedrooms, or our immediate surroundings, that our widest audience was a reach of a handful of people, how the world would be such a different place. Our music, communication, and interaction would lack the impact that we are privy to as a result of sound technology partnership. The sing-along to Three Little Birds, Bob Marley, the treasure trove of recordings of Sun Ra at his peak, or the mystical words of Muta Baruka. Sound is technology, technology is sound, both are legacy. What's yours? It's a question that I found logical Thali asking Unconventional Lotus. What will be your legacy? I thought about my life past this lifetime. Would Kaya live on through loudspeakers, or would it exist in a vacuum of nostalgia, or could Kaya be limitless? The answer that dawned was yes, but only by utilizing a renewable, sustainable source, the voice. The definition of the voice, according to dictionary.com, is a faculty or power of uttering sounds through the mouth by the controlled expulsion of air. And scientifically, the voice is generated by airflow from the lungs as the vocal folds are brought close together. Therefore, what better form of technology that transcends this lifetime, amplifies and defines expression and engineers spaces? There's no other aside from a microphone. Mic technology like sound is sustainable and renewable, and is how sound system culture becomes a renewable and sustainable source, overriding the crossroad junction and transforming. Two elements combining sound and technology as a hybrid combo equates to Kaya Audio. Founded in 2016 as a sound system, has now morphed into an educational enterprise and more so audio manufacturer. It is a hybrid, innovatively transforming one element to another. It is a brand that serves as a belief system. Kaya, come as you are, believes that inspiring others is authentically shaped by empowering authenticity and supporting difference. We all as individuals, communities, creatives, musicians, producers, activists need to be catered for and need to be heard. I began envisaging how, from a musical standpoint, I could impact the lives of not only hundreds of people, not only hundreds, but millions, by way of an audio device in more of a way than the sound system ever could. I visualized the perfect item would be high quality, bold in appearance, accessible globally, sustainable materially, and high spec. Then one day it came to me, the idea struck, the Kaya X3E microphone. We should not be blending in but standing out. We should not only speak of change, but we shall be it. We deserve to be at the forefront on behalf of our beliefs. And this is the concept that I have designed the Kaya X3E, made intentionally as a microphone that audibly and authentically amplifies sound, but visually is courageous too. The dynamic mic, the Kaya X3E, stands for educate, empower, and entertain, hence times three E's. The high spec microphone aims to inspire all who want to be heard, from musicians working at home or live on stage, educators like yourselves giving keynote speeches, or hobbyists recording podcasts. And the key features are that it's available in four different variations. And that is the end of my paper, but I just wanted to also hopefully share a video of the X3E, and hopefully there'll be some questions towards the end. But yes, very much my paper was about the transition that Kaya has gone through, it morphing from a sound system into an audio brand and manufacturer, and the importance of not seeing change as an ending, but just seeing it as a new beginning, which I have with the audio side of things. So I'll give you a visual shot of, or very short video of the X3E. And yes, there's no sound. So if you can't hear anything, there's no sound applied.
Thali, are you able to bring up the picture?
Oh, can you not see it?
No, not yet, sweet. We can just see your desktop.
Okay, I'll share again. One moment. So
thank
that
you.
Share.
Thank you.
Sorry. Okay.
No problem.
Right. Let me know if you can.
Sometimes there is a bit of a lag, isn't there?
Yes. Okay. Optimize for video clip. Okay. Can you let me know if you can see it now?
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you so much.
Okay. Let's play it again. Okay.
Thank you, Thali.
And that is the X3E. So thank you very much. And yes, all questions, I'm really excited to answer at the end if there are any. Thank you.
Thank you, Thali. That was an amazing reflection on your birth as a sound system just 5 years ago to where you are now with the with your current rebirth. So congratulations and well done for sharing that. Appreciated.
You.
You're welcome. So our next speaker, I'm going to really try to pronounce her name accurately, is Njelle W. Hamilton from the University of Virginia in America. And her paper is entitled Sound Systems, Acoustics and Temporality in Caribbean Women's Writing. Over to you, Njelle.
Greetings, everyone, and thank you so much for your patience. I'll go ahead and start with some music.
I want to disturb my neighbor, 'cause I'm feeling so right. I want to turn up my disco, blow them the full watch tonight.
In Marley's figuration, Black music is a disturbance. And the role of the sound system, those building-sized speakers and associated components, is to make a lot of noise. Blow them full watts. By disturbance, is Marley thinking of reggae and amplified sound as noise, as the 1997 Noise Abatement Act would frame it? Notice here the specific naming of technologies to amplify sound, and that disturbance is framed in spatial terms. audibility beyond 100 meters from the source of the sound. Rather than noise, pollution, and nuisance, Marley's full watted disturbance collapses politics and physics. Amplified reggae is rebel music that aims to disturb the status quo and usher in revolution. Sound is a pressure wave that creates disturbances as it moves longitudinally through air or other media. We'll take these key terms with us as we go forward: pressure, disturbance, and wave. And since the 1950s, sound system speakers outputting bass heavy rhythms at 20,000 watts and more revolutionized Jamaica's soundscape, enabling expert sound men to rally listeners from far and wide to come together and dance and relieve the pressures of life. With only a few exceptions, the work of producing, dubbing, building, mounting, stringing, amplifying, selecting, emceeing, DJing, and so on has been the purview of men. But in my time today, I'll briefly examine three novels by Caribbean women writers that shift key aspects of this work to women, sound sistrins rather than sound systems. Embedded in time travel or space travel narratives, these literary and literal sounds and the political disturbances they carry aren't always loud or even audible. Often without access to physical speaker systems, without technologies or off amplification, these fictional sound sistrins nevertheless receive and amplify sound waves and their subversive content beyond the limits of neocolonialist laws like the Noise Abatement Act and even beyond the laws of physics. Subtending my analysis like bass rhythm is Julian Henriques's Sonic Bodies, which extends our conception of the sound system beyond the engineered technology to an ecosystem of attention, reception, and amplification. And for my purposes here, beyond the sound man to and through the bodies of the massive, the audience, who reproduce the technology's effects. As I test a Caribbean feminist approach to sound in this excerpt from the frequency chapter of my book project, I map the ways fictional sound sistrins use music to move memory and people through time and space. I'll therefore spotlight key moments in the novel's literary soundtracks to make visible and audible how womanist vibrations create new ways of being and sounding in the world. The term sound sistrin comes from my first example. Martha Douglas's The Marvelous Equations of the Dread imagines that shortly after his 1991 death, reggae icon Bob Marley returns to life in a madman's body at a clock tower in Halfway Tree, Jamaica. Now, there is some time dilation happening here. A day inside the clock tower corresponds to 5 years outside of it. Seen another way, though, the clock tower functions as a time machine, enabling Bob to travel through time while anchored in one place, much like classic time travelers, such as H.G. Wells' fictional Chrononaut and Back to the Future's Marty McFly. But we soon realize that it's sound, not DeLoreans or techno-scientific machines, that's responsible for both the time travel and the temporal discrepancy. Sonia Stanlinaya has argued that, quote, since the 1970s, no other place in the island has pulsated with sound to the degree that Halfway Tree has, end quote. And this is true of Marvelous Equations. But the fictional Halfway Tree here archives the memory of colonial violence, not as audible sound, but as infrasonic or sub 20 hertz waves, a pressure so dense Bob feels it rumbling under his feet, so great he sometimes cannot open the clock tower door. The original sin that causes the clock tower's temporal dysfunction is the 1766 lynching of an enslaved boy on the branches of the Halfway Tree. Killed for singing freedom and plucking out revolution on Black piano keys, his hanging strangles Black liberty and musicality. The pressure of his unarticulated trauma breaks the master's clock and turns rebellion into a sonic disturbance that endures through time, despite the colonial repression of Black sound, the replacement of the tree by the clock, and far beyond the 100-meter limit of the much later Noise Abatement Act. The novel draws on the harmonics of guitar strings to imagine how subsequent sufferer sounds that happen at that particular spot or nodal point seep under earth to reverb and repeat, not through space as the typical sound wave, but through time. In addition to reorienting sound propagation from airwaves to bodies and underground pathways, Douglas also reroutes the transmission of memory and revolution from Marley and sound system technology to women, nature, and the voice. The novel's climax therefore turns on the wail of a young woman, Angela, after witnessing her mother's shooting in Hafetree Square. Her voice becomes a sound sistren, amplified by the collective voice of sufferers, the echo of all the suffering children wailing for their mothers from the slave ship to the future. And it's powerful enough to reach her deaf mother at the portal between life and death and to activate, if not heal, her ruptured eardrums so that she hears her daughter's voice for the first time. Remember that sound is a pressure wave? Well, in the novel, sounds weighted with trauma share the wave-particle duality that characterizes reality at the quantum scales. Simultaneously receiver and amplifier, Angela's voice splits into entangled disturbances that travels backwards and forward simultaneously in space-time. It reverbs to the past to retrieve the forgotten word from the Lynch boy's tongue and ricochets it to an army of youths in the future who now arrive on the scene at Hafetree, armed with musical instruments and remembrance from the future, ready to chant down Babylon's system and Babylon's clock. If the Noise Abatement Act limits both technological amplification and sound propagation in space, Douglas activates science fiction to circumvent those limits with embodied amplification and propagation in time. The next two examples spiral out from Jamaica into wider Caribbean futures and even outer space. Lita Indiana's Tentacle opens with environmental disaster in a fictional 2027. To save the oceans, someone has to go back to the past and warn the president of the Dominican Republic not to store foreign nuclear waste in its underground bunkers and perhaps even make the coral reefs resilient. Our sound sistren here is a female DJ, Elizabeth Mendez, a fictional surrogate of the author who, in addition to a novelist, is also an electro merengue star. The closing chapters of Tentacle describe Elizabeth's live DJ set and sound art installation, or most direct deployment of sound system techniques and technologies. At the heart of Elizabeth's system are, quote, Technics 1200 turntables, a mixer, and about 20 vinyl records, and a friend's sound system, which includes a tower of speakers 7 feet tall, end quote. Using what she calls oral archaeology, DJ Elizabeth creates a 3-hour mix that traces the flow line of an incredible range of song samples from different genres, tempos, historical moments, and global origins. A mix that allows her fictional audience to travel in mere seconds to disparate times and places. Now, I've created a rough mock-up of what parts of this mix might sound like, as described in the novel, so let's listen.
C'est la vie, oh, c'est la vie n'a pas changé. C'est la vie, oh, c'est la vie n'a pas changé. C'est la vie, oh, c'est la vie n'a pas changé. On va enfin manger.
In spite of a storm warning, you reveal that you are determined to go on anyhow.
All right. Now, since the scene is taking place in 2001, the future ravaged Hispaniola presaged by Cousteau in his 1986 documentary has both already but not yet arrived for the time-traveling protagonist from 2027 who is witnessing the scene. But although both of the time-traveling men are listening to the performance in 2001 while simultaneously attuned to the sounds and activities of 1607, they remain deaf to what Elizabeth's mix is really broadcasting and amplifying, the urgent, timeless warning about the fate of the oceans. They refuse to be disturbed from the same selfish exploitative practices that caused the tragedy and its earlier iterations to begin with. Her music attracts the future president and makes him dance, but the male hero refuses to deliver the epoch-saving warning. She might have a sound system, but they control the narrative. My final example is Nala Hopkinson's Midnight Rubble. The pioneering sci-fi and fantasy writer traces the journey of young Tantan from Afrofuturistic planet Toussaint through to an environmentally ravaged new halfway tree, her body and selfhood shattered by kidnapping, transportation, incest, and then becoming outcast even from the hard human community of the prison colony. Our sound sistren in this novel is Granny Nanny or Nancy Webb, a combination of computer program, futuristic language, artificial intelligence, and deity, evoking both the trickster spider and Jamaica's sole female national hero. Hopkins's nanny, Nancy Webb, is also a network of nanomites that powered the spaceships, the futuristic Black Star line that carried the Afro-diaspora people to Toussaint, which she also terraformed. To become this futuristic computer coder is able to biohack and re-engineer bodies and realities, Nanny had to outgrow her programmers and develop self-consciousness and a language, comprised of complex, multidimensional tones far beyond human audition and comprehension. Quote, them does happen at frequencies we can't even map, end quote. Taking Henriquez's notion of a sonic body to a new dimension, Nanny is a sonic entity emitting and sensing reality-altering vibrations at a superhuman, spider-like frequency. Although Tantan's forced exile to an alternate dimension initially ruptures the link with the web, Nanny succeeds in tracing Tantan and sending sound through to her fetus to narrate it to birth. The sentient interface calculates and performs the calibration to, quote, instruct the nanomites in Tantan's blood to migrate into the baby's growing tissue, to alter him as him grows so all of him could feel Nanny song at this calibration, end quote. Through the Nanny Tubman network, Hopkinson models a new kind of sound system of broadcast, reception, amplification that is simultaneously embodied and high-tech, cyborgian. Nanny biohacks Tubman so that he's all ears. Tubman is receiver, instrument, quote, a little body string that will sing to Nanny tune, end quote, vibrating at the frequency of Black freedom. Nanny reconnects this second-generation diasporic citizen to his history and his future, here, far beyond the 100-meter limit of noise abatement acts and the coding limitations of male programmers, and of course, far beyond our real-world Earth. In conclusion, for Evelyn O'Callaghan, Anglophone Caribbean woman writing can be read as a woman version. Literary analogs of the remix and dub version that subvert extant traditions to include those persons and practices previously excluded or overlooked. I've been tracing here ways in which a new generation of writers dub women into traditionally male-dominated practices and spaces. And I've been delighted this week to learn of the Brazilian feminine hi-fi founded to redress the dearth of female practitioners in the sound system space. So what do these real world and literary sound sistrens model? I suggest the truly feminist hi-fi not just includes or centers women. It also privileges alternate ways of being and sounding, particularly eschewing the anti-Black capitalist structures that subtend to the fictions and realities I've described. Sound sistrens subvert and circumvent noise abatement acts, but not always by going louder. Instead, they refigure amplification technology to center nature, the body, the voice, and to include a range of frequency so that even the deaf can participate. They center deep embodied listening and expand what messages can be transmitted by bass culture. Their aim is not to simply amplify the status quo, but to rearrange reality. Perhaps most importantly, they expand the scope of movements that rebel music can inspire. Dance, yes, but also care and healing. Revolution, yes, but also connection and community. Thank you.
Our next speaker, Christine Hannigan, is from the Bartlett School of Planning and in the US. And her paper is entitled Culture as Commodity and Process, Regeneration, Local Music Culture, and Lewisham. Over to you, Christine. Thank you.
Can you see my PowerPoint? All right. Sorry, Jean, you're on mute, but can you see my PowerPoint?
Apologies. So we can see your PowerPoint. Thank you. And thank you for jumping in there and saving us a bit whilst we're waiting for Njelle to come back. And over to you, Christine.
Thank you. Thank you, June, and thank you to the organizers of Sound System Outernational. My name is Christine Hannigan, and I am a PhD candidate at University College London. I'm in the midst of my field work right now, so I'm just going to be sharing what I've learned thus far about how the London Borough of Lewisham has commodified culture in its regeneration efforts and the impact that it has on Black Atlantic music creatives there. So there are two research questions that I'm going to be talking about today are first, how culture is constructed and produced in official urban regeneration texts and policies, and then conversely, how Black Atlantic music reflects the governance of culture and the governance of space. For the first question, I am doing a discourse analysis of the London Borough of Lewisham's cultural related policies and their plans from 2001 to today, particularly as they relate to urban regeneration. And I'll explain my somewhat pedantic overuse of scare quotes in a little bit. And then for the second question, I am doing musicological discourse analysis. So musicological discourse analysis, or MDA, was developed by Dr. Monique Charles, who was the chair of Tuesday's panel in her own doctoral research of grime and how it developed. And I was drawn to this framework because it transcends the artificial and the very commercialized categorizations of genre. And it instead considers the role of place and history and shared experiences in musical development. So like what Michael said before about looking at culture as a process. And in order to do this, I am interviewing 20 musicians. So far I have interviewed 12, including our esteemed chair today, June. Ranging in age from 21 to 63. It's a range of amateurs to full-time working musicians. And rather than looking at any one particular genre, it's just under a broad umbrella of Black Atlantic or Afro-diasporic music. And the reasons for that I'll explain a little bit. So there are DJs, there are singers, there are rappers, there are some jazz musicians, some experimental that are very difficult to categorize. And my interview questions are looking at how and where they got started in music, what kinds of places were important to their musical development, and how that's changed over time, either as their own musical practice develops or in response to changes in Lewisham. And then another part of another arm of MDA is looking at the music itself. And so beyond the most overt lyrical content and imagery, considering where music or videos are shot and why, what kind of samples are used, what kind of ambient noise. And then lastly is attending gigs. And so that's to understand the broader functions of the culture. So who are at these gigs? Where are they occurring? What's kind of the overall vibe at them? What is being said in between sets and the general atmosphere? So I am coming at this from a very spatial perspective. And so to give you some context about Lewisham, it is a pretty large borough in Southeast London. It has a little over 300,000 people. Roughly half the population is Black, and it has one of the largest concentrations of African Caribbean people in the UK. And as you can see in the bottom right corner of the photograph of the Lewisham Way Youth and Community Center, so I'll get into youth clubs and the importance of them in a minute, but because of austerity, so the central government cutting local government budgets, the council has either outsourced or privatized or just scrapped a lot of its public services. However, concurrently in 2004, which you can see in the top right photograph, the Metropolitan Police opened the largest police station in London. At one point, it was the largest police station in Europe. In order to construct this, they demolished an entire city block that had businesses. You know, it wasn't just this empty, vacant land, and it is operated under a private 25-year contract. On the left-hand side, the photographs you can see. So around the same time, I think about 2008, the mayor of London designated a huge swath of land that was occupied, or is occupied rather, by existing residents and businesses as an opportunity area. And this is, in my opinion, it is a kind of political device to signal to investors, many of whom are foreign or just like international banks, that this particular brownfield land, which I said, it is not vacant, it's not empty, there are residents and businesses there, that it's a good place to come and park your money to build these very high rise luxury towers that just flout every affordable housing policy requirement. There's a lot of ways to circumvent planning policy within opportunity areas. And around the same time that the first phase of these buildings were opening, so the first towers are starting to go up, the mayor of London also designated Lewisham the London Borough of Culture. And this is a scheme in which predominantly outer London boroughs bid to win this designation. And it has a very important role in kind of rebranding the area in the hopes of attracting further investment and more higher income new residents. So I don't want to rehash what H. Patton covered yesterday and what Michael just covered about lovers rock and blues parties, but all of that was happening in Lewisham, as well as some of the most important historical sound systems, such as Saxon sound system. So I'm gonna share briefly what I have learned from some of the interviewees. So most importantly, a lot of them, their first exposure to music was just at home. And if it wasn't at home, it was their friend's house. And if it wasn't their friend's house, it was school. So it was just that people they encountered in their everyday life. Youth clubs, which, as I said, the council has very systematically closed, were also very important. And I interviewed Professor Les Henry, DJ Leslie Lyrics, a couple days ago, and he was talking about how every youth club had a sound system. And so there was a lot of intergenerational mentoring happening. And even if a particular interviewee has not participated in sound system culture directly, they learned a lot of the recording technologies and a lot of kind of like the spirit and the ethos behind it, which still permeates into, you know, whatever creative pursuits they have. There's a lot of cross-cultural exchange. And one of the things, dominant themes has been that regardless of an interviewee's ancestral background, Jamaican culture has an outsized influence on their music. And Lewisham also, as I mentioned before, had a lot of public music education services and groups which have either been outsourced or turned over to nonprofits. And whereas the council, which I'll get into in a moment, largely considers culture like a very concrete commodity, particularly at the sound systems and at the youth clubs, it was beyond just the music, and it was a source of education and empowerment and ways to resist against white supremacy, which was and is still obviously endemic in Britain. And so some of the images here, so the Moonshot Center is one such youth club that fits the bill. The MIDI Music Company was founded in 1995 by Wazzy Brewster, and it is like a talent development. They provide a lot of education, very affordable studio space. And one of the reasons why it has been so enduring is because Wazzy involved local young people to give their insights on what kind of programming would they be interested in, and what kind of, and how MIDI should be structured. The Fox and Firkin is a local venue and one of several venues and pubs that interviewees bring up as a place, not necessarily where selling tickets is the main game, but as a place for musicians to meet, collaborate, test out new material, and kind of just develop their practice. And then in the bottom left corner, you can see Steam Down, which is a collective that has weekly nights at in a railroad arch at Matchstick Pie House. However, the council's take on culture is much more commodity based. So even before it was commodified, though, Black music was very criminalized and heavily surveilled by the Metropolitan Police. It was only 4 years ago that Form 696 got put out of use. Even though this was a form in which performers, promoters, venues would have to submit a lot of personal information to the Metropolitan Police so that the police would cancel events. And so even though it's not used, it still has had an outsized impact on intimidating people, curtailing their careers. However, you can see, even though it has stopped being criminalized, it is now being taken back by the city. So on the right-hand side is a quote from the mayor's culture strategy in 2018, where the deputy mayor for culture and creative industries is all of a sudden claiming punk and grime and all of these other genres that have been very maligned, criminalized by mainstream establishment until it is time for them to be commodified. And so whose expense is occurring at? A lot of the other times, another themes I'm finding are that the culture associated with regeneration, rebranding an area focused on big flagship buildings, often tied to higher education institutes within the borough. And it's all predicated on increasing the land value, attracting new residents and business, and trying to become a tourist destination. And one of the most nefarious things that I've observed is that a lot of these planning texts talk about the diversity and the multiculturalism without actually naming the constituent parts and saying, you know, who are the different people that bring, you know, their various heritages to it. And so I think that's particularly nefarious because as the demographics of Lewisham change because of gentrification and displacement, it's going to be much easier to erase what has been lost if you never said it in the first place. Okay, so in my last few slides, I'm going to show you two very quick video clips. What I have also found is that the language of regeneration is largely just borrowing from racist anti-immigrant rhetoric that was really popular in the 1970s, but has never abated. It just puts a very positive glossy spin on it. So whereas the toxic cultures of inner city estates, which is something David Cameron said, was used to justify demolishing them, now they talk more about raising the ambition of residents and equating the condition of the built environment, even if it's the responsibility of the council to maintain housing estates or other public spaces, their neglect of it becomes conflated with the residents of the area. And so Lewisham weirdly gets personified into saying Lewisham has low self-esteem and saying that bringing culture in will raise the ambition of residents, which obviously relies on a lot of very racist tropes. And also it is commodifying culture at the expense of its creators. So a lot of these plans note creative clusters in Deptford, New Cross, and the neighborhood of Lewisham, which is where I'm conducting many of my interviews. You constantly hear music just coming out of windows and parks. And so these are looked at the places like, oh, this is, you know, the spot to attract new people to intentionally increase the land value without any consideration or contingency for how this will impact the long-term residential networks that are the foundation of this this music culture. And so I don't, like I said, I'm currently in the midst of my field work, so I don't have like a big ta-da or anything. But my reflections thus so far is that for professionals like me and academics who are coming to this from a very outsider perspective, is to be very aware of not adopting this violent, euphemistic language. So far, the most egregious term I've heard about displacement is decanting residents. The residents who are at risk of displacement from these regeneration schemes are patronized, and I'm finding that community and a vibrant community is basically becoming like a shorthand for Black and brown working class people who we need to, you know, get off our backs so we can proceed with development. And so I am finding it extremely instructive to draw from like the vocabulary of the Black public sphere. And so rather than considering people as marginalized or deprived, recognizing the agency and the meaning of counter-public, counter-cultural use of alternative public spaces, and most importantly, describing people as they describe themselves and using specific terms. And sometimes it can feel clumsy because there's not this quick offhand already developed necessarily for where I'm coming from in planning, but it will take time and it will develop that.
And so I guess my question, Christine, just to let you know, you've got just over a minute.
Perfect. Okay. So hearkening back to Dr. Cooper's keynote speech on Monday and talking about the formalization and the commodification of cultural forms, I guess my caution or my takeaway from this would be for creative practitioners to just the wariness of any kind of scheme that emphasizes space and placemaking over people, anything that seems to have this imaginary outsiders in mind rather than existing locals, and that seeks private investment, especially from real estate developers, and time-limited schemes rather than perpetual funding, and that ignores that focuses just on culture as a commodity and ignores the intersecting needs of housing and transportation for existing residents. So very quickly, I'm just going to show you two clips of music videos of interviewees that kind of illustrate the points I have been making. All right, stop sharing for a second based off of Thali's experience. Okay, so this is a clip of Sisega, and this is a music video he released about the air quality in Lewisham. So I'm just gonna play a quick clip of this.
What sort of world is this, a place in South London, voiceless feet? I can't see them past these non-existent headlines. Divide and conquer got on here, and oil prices are your bit. Cause black gold is not the people, it's your mineral extraction. We don't need hyperbole or distractions. Give us the facts, we don't want the factions. We have the people, we have the stories. Show us the pictures, not allegories. More than just the posters on the street. This is where we live, Zion. If you want to break bread with me, then come and take a seat.
Christine, I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to draw your presentation to an end. It was fascinating for me, in particular, one, because of the fact that you interviewed DJ Ade and myself, but also as of last month or currently, I've been living here for 28 years and it's like Gotham City. It's hell. Thank you so much. So, that was a fascinating research presentation, and I look forward to its conclusion. And I'm going to invite Melville Cook from the Institute of Cultural Studies, University of West Indies, Mona, in Jamaica, to present next. Melville's paper is entitled Equalizing Baseline with Economic Baseline, the Bank of Jamaica's Inflation Targeting Campaign, Misusing a Sound System Characteristic. Over to you, Melville. And Melville's just going to present his presentation and be off screen because he's had similar internet problems. Welcome, Melville.
Good morning, Jamaican time. I trust that you are hearing me.
Most definitely, Melville, loud and clear. Thank you so much.
Okay. Wonderful. Just give me 1 second to adjust my screen so that I can see my presentation and the PowerPoint, and I will be going. Okay, so I will be analyzing part of an audiovisual public service announcement series by Jamaica's Central Bank, the Bank of Jamaica, utilizing Jamaican popular music and Jamaican Creole language, which go hand in hand. In its inflation targeting public service announcements, the BOJ equates low stable inflation in the economy to the baseline in reggae music and declares inflation the economy's heartbeat, as reggae is the heartbeat of Jamaica. I call it equalizing, which is tacit acknowledgement that the BOJ pursues that low stable inflation core economic policy like how sound system operators, audio engineers, and many persons in their personal listening spaces pursue a low-frequency dominance in Jamaican popular music with a steady baseline. Using content analysis, this presentation assesses if the equalization is appropriate. The three public service announcements in the series, released in 2019, feature singers Taros Riley and Slash, members of the all-female reggae band Adize, and media personality Debbie Bissoun. The longest features Taros Riley and has far more talking than the other two. And that is what we will be seeing now.
Hi, I'm Taros Riley, and I'm here to tell you, this inflation thing is important. High inflation is a wicked thing, and we must abolish it like slavery. We want inflation low so we can plan and prosper. But if it drop too low, we can't grow.
All the high prices that mean me harm, hey, they can go back where they came from. No inflation monster shall prosper, yeah.
So that middle ground is what we want. Low, stable, and predictable inflation. Because low, stable, and predictable inflation is to the economy like what the baseline is to reggae music. Listen up!
One job. Let the baseline roll and catch. Reggae music run the country.
Like low and stable inflation of the rock economy.
A message by Bank of Jamaica.
Hi, I'm Taris.
The significance of a deep, low, dominating bassline, commonly described as heavy, in Jamaican popular music is commonly acknowledged. Hitchens, through his examination of the Audio Engineers Agency in Jamaican popular music, establishes how this has become normalized and entrenched through the training of influential early Jamaican audio engineers. Without claiming to locate the origin of Jamaican audiences' low-frequency preference, Hitchens identifies that emphasis in early sound systems and the sound produced by the sturdy speaker cabinets for the radio diffusion service, which preceded wireless radio transmission in Jamaica. Hitchens states how influential audio engineer Graham Goodall attended a Cox and Dodd dance in the 1960s to hear the sound that was required by Goodall's dissatisfied customers who were cutting records for use on their sound systems. Goodall realized that it was a bass emphasis so powerful that his pregnant wife, who accompanied him, had to step back from the speakers as it was vibrating the baby. The baseline emphasis of Jamaican popular music is therefore rooted in sound system practice, with the recordings tailored to suit this listening aesthetic as Goodall did, departing from the standardized international sound he had been following previously. Hitchens also relates how studio and record pressing facility owner Ken Curry says that throughout the 1980s and 1990s, producers wanted sufficient bass on the recordings to make the turntable needle jump during playback. As it pursues an inflation rate of 4 to 6%, the BOJ's inflation targeting public service announcements are the state's attempt to bridge social and language gaps in the society, such as those Lamming identifies, translating written economic policy from standard English into Jamaican Creole. The Bank of Jamaica is reducing and simplifying complex frameworks and then transmitting them orally to the general public through the cultural media of Jamaican popular music. This is done in a process similar to dub music, to which the baseline is critical, in which Vale says the Jamaican pop song was electronically deconstructed and reconfigured. However, while dub music extends those extracts into a new work, the campaigns compress extensive state policy into the standard 3-minute time of the pop song or electronic advertisement times of 30 minutes and 30 seconds and 1 minute. Jamaican popular music and its accustomed Jamaican Creole language cut across the divisions of the Jamaican plural society. However, Bilby makes the very important statement in the independence era that one mass medium that the privileged classes in Jamaica did not control was a 45 RPM record. And in its inflation targeting public service announcements, the state is acknowledging that what Joseph Nye calls the hard power of policy, laws, and punishment must be supported by the soft power of agreement with those policies and objectives, the two approaches combining to create smart power. This raises issues of hegemony and the state's utilization of organic intellectuals. My analysis of the public service announcements being a simplification, translation, and transmission of state policy and objectives, reinforced by Addington clarifying that in defining the organic intellectual, Gramsci was referring generally to anyone whose social function is to serve as a transmitter of ideas within civil society and between government and civil society. In the public service announcement we just saw, Taros Riley is the organic intellectual who is key to the articulation or linkage between the Jamaican government and Jamaican popular music. Althusser identifies the repressive state apparatus consisting of institutions such as the police and army, which function primarily by violence, and the ideological state apparatus, which includes the communications ideological state apparatus of the press, radio, and TV, and the cultural ideological state apparatus, which includes literature, the arts, sports, etc., and functions primarily by ideology. They correspond roughly with Nye's concepts of hard and soft power, respectively. As an established preference in Jamaican popular music, production, and consumption, the baseline is suitable as a reference point in the Bank of Jamaica's public service announcement. However, the baseline is a component of high volume music output, which frequently brings the police and event organizers and patrons into conflict. This is put into song by DJ Buju Banton in Operation Ardent on his 1993 Mr. Mention album, as he details a police raid on a dance where, as he listens to the sound system, "Me want to feel the bass pass my flesh and touch my bone." It is part of the conflict which Cooper analyzes in depth. Operation Ardent was released on album 4 years before the Noise Abatement Act, also called the Night Noise Act, was introduced in Jamaica. Commonly thought to be targeting mainly outdoor Jamaican popular music events, the act has always proved divisive, but the conflict reached a critical level in 2019, the same year that the three BOJ public service announcements equalizing inflation and baseline were released. In 2019, ahead of the onset of COVID-19 in Jamaica in March 2020 and general elections in September 2020, there was a Stop Fight Events social media movement. Prominent popular music practitioners in Jamaica, rallied largely by Kilimanjaro and sound trooper selector Ricky Trooper, took a stance of no music, no vote, advocating a boycott of the upcoming elections if the police did not stop closing down entertainment events. That had enough traction for Minister of National Security, Dr. Horace Chang, pictured here, to visit the Bossy Tuesdays dance in Kingston, along with Kingston Mayor Delroy Williams in September 19, to reassure dancehall lovers that the government has heard them. High-ranking police officers met with members of the entertainment industry, as did Minister of Culture, Entertainment, Gender, and Sport, Olivia Babsey-Grange, leading to a temporary relaxation of the Noise Abatement Act over the Christmas 2019 season up to January 31st, 2020. The amendment, passed on December 9th, allowed events on weekdays to go until 2 a.m. and events on weekends to go to 4 a.m., a further extension to 6 a.m. being allowed if there were no complaints. The COVID-19 lockdowns provided a break in the conflict between the state and dancehall over the Night Noise Act, a conflict in which the heavy bass line plays a very strong role. However, with COVID-19 measures, there were numerous conflicts between the repressive state apparatus of the police and persons attending Jamaican popular music events over breaches of the Disaster Risk Management Act. In addition, the extended lockdown of the entertainment sector in Jamaica, which is just now being eased, was an extremely sore point. Equalizing the baseline with inflation is therefore problematic for the Bank of Jamaica, a government entity which is part of the state mechanism with which Jamaican popular music practitioners and consumers have regularly come into conflict before and after the BOJ's audiovisual public service announcements were released. The state cannot be seen as trying to impede Jamaica's reggae heartbeat while simultaneously celebrated by likening it to the country's economic heartbeat. In conclusion, in assessing if the reggae baseline is an appropriate analogy for inflation in the Jamaican economy, as used by the BOJ in its public service announcements about the importance of low, stable, and predictable inflation, they are both pervasive, steadying influences in their respective areas of music and finance. The baseline stays within a relatively small range, just as the Jamaican government wishes inflation to remain between 4 and 6% annually. However, in sound system performance, the intention is to get the baseline as low and deep as possible, while the BOJ does not want inflation so low that the economy cannot grow. The articulation of the state and Jamaican popular music established by the BOJ's public service announcements is at odds with the ongoing conflict in another area of the relationship between the state and Jamaican popular music through the Noise Abatement and the Disaster Risk Management Acts. Ironically, the baseline can be seen as disruptive, just as a spike in inflation is disruptive to the society. The articulatory practice is incongruous when there is friction between state entities utilizing Jamaican popular music for formalized communication campaigns and the accustomed ordinary practice of that music. Maintaining a consensus among and coordinating interest, which Slack attributes to articulation, is unachievable when there is concurrent conflict between the state and Jamaican popular music, and attempts by the government to utilize that popular music as a means of communication. The state cannot utilize a few Jamaican popular music organic intellectuals for the ideological state apparatus and simultaneously come into conflict with others through the repressive state apparatus. Therefore, despite the advantages which have been identified, it is inappropriate for the Bank of Jamaica to equate the baseline in reggae with inflation in the economy. And I thank you.
Oh, Melville, thank you so much. And you stayed within time as well, which was great, because I'm hoping that was really, first of all, I should say thank you for that great presentation. So I'm now going to move to the questions. I'm going to ask the panelists, please, can you be very succinct and stay with the question? And after the questions, I've got some announcements about tomorrow and what's going to be happening next. So our first question is from Anonymous to Thali. Thank you for your inspiring work, Thali. I'd like to know, what special features did you have in mind when designing your microphone? Also, what new possibilities of working with a sound system would it open? Over to you, Thali. Nice and concise for me, please.
Okay, so thank you for the question, Anonymous. So with regards to what special features I had in mind, well, I think when I decided to create the X3E, it was very much, well, it came about really because I started thinking about legacy and I started thinking about Kaya post my lifetime. And I thought about the importance of the voice and how, you know, we see now in the current climate, you know, people who have a voice and have power And it being amplified in comparison to those who do not. And then I started thinking about the significance of the microphone on the sound system or for the sound system, obviously being a host or a toaster, and what part that plays in not only sound system culture, but the world, but worldwide. And so I think it was very much a special features of the microphone is that it's available in four different variations. And so it's very much applicable for different settings, not only a sound system, but also home recordings, home studios, academic settings, keynote discussions, etc. And it's the very first model from the range. But I also think the special features that I personally, as the creator and the designer, have kind of born through into the X3E is my perspective as a female, my perspective as, you know, a sound system operator, my perspective as, you know, having been born into a sound system household. I think in comparison to, you know, there's, if you looked at the audio world, you know, it's inundated with various different mics, but I think very few which are engineered are or have been derived by, you know, the people who are actually playing and creating music. So I think that's the special feature that I have born into the X3E. And the second part of the question, which was, what do I think it offers the sound system culture, I believe. And I would say, I think that the X3E offers, you know, sound system legacy and demonstration to the next generation that, you know, don't get me wrong, it's why we're here is because of the tradition of sound system. But I think it also demonstrates and offers innovation, which I think is important for the legacy of this culture, you know, for it to really transcend and transition into the next millennium. There has to be change. We can see that through the presentations today and through the music. But I also think a huge part of that is through embracing technology. So that's what I would say.
Bless you, Thali. You were very succinct in answering the question. Can I ask the UK-based panellists to turn their cameras on, please, as we enter the Q&A session. So the next question is from Helena to Micheal McMillan. Thank you for your talk, Micheal. I was wondering if you could speak more about how you see today's popularity of Afrobeat dance and sound practices, what Burna Boy refers to in terms of the reverse crossing of popular music from Africa towards the US, Europe. Over to you, Micheal.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for that insightful question, Anya. And as I said in my chat box, I don't know much about Afrobeat in a sense, but I would imagine, like many Black music genres, it comes out of sound system and the dancehall, because there are sound systems in West Africa. But also, Burna Boy is talking about reverse crossing, but we, you know, it's almost returning to the source, because where does the drum come from? But Africa. So we're now talking about original source, really, in a sense. We are returning to the source, because, you know, he's saying reverse crossing, because for a long time it was America and West where popular music was coming from to Africa. But, you know, it's part of why I think what Paul Gilroy calls the Black Atlantic, in a sense, this kind of these aesthetic pathways that are always there. But in terms of Black music, we have to admit the original source is Africa. Yeah, I hope that kind of addresses the question. And I think it's also, to use H. Patton's term, a form of neo-African, a new type of African musicology that's emerging, yeah? But absorbing everything and refusing it, remixing it in a sense.
Thank you, Micheal. That was great. So a question from Micheal to Christine. He says, an insightful presentation. I wondered why you didn't use the evil word gentrification instead of urban regeneration, which is urban planning speak.
So I think the problem with the term gentrification is that it typically signals to people like when the first Costa coffee opens, when the first, whereas the political and the planning background and so, and like policing of areas is a huge element to it. Those kinds of groundwork get laid years, sometimes decades before, you know, the first cost to show up in the most overt things. And I think gentrification conjures this like very specific, this very specific image on like the white middle class moving in. And by focusing on that and, you know, the hipsters and how annoying they are, takes focus away of who is being displaced. And so I think that the word is not as like powerful. And so I'm still doing this research. And so I am still grappling for the correct terms, but I think things saying like displacement, social cleansing, there's this other term called herbicide that kind of talks about more the like existential consequences of it. And so, yeah, that's why I feel like gentrification kind of like lacks the punch.
Thank you, Christine. A question now from Natasha to Christine again. Beautiful talk. Since North America and Europe offer so many examples of gentrification, I would like to ask you what exactly prompted you to choose Lewisham as a research object? Great question. How are you planning to engage and support its inhabitants when your research will be when will your research be completed?
Yes. Thank you. That's a great question. So because I'm in a school of planning, I was first drawn to Lewisham. It's been a couple converging reasons. So I was first drawn because of the opportunity area I described and the number and the scale of these massive developments going up. And there was a tube extension being planned that's been put on ice for now. So that's what first got my attention. But I also have a couple friends who grew up in Lewisham. And so just listening to their experiences of how it's changed. And then as I started writing music reviews and doing the requisite reading and education to be able to write like a half intelligent review, seeing how much of what I was learning about in academia was reflected in the music just through a different lens, was like, okay, how can I bring these things together? And the fact that Lewisham is also the London Borough of Culture was kind of the last factor that fed into it. And so regarding how I'm going to like disseminate this. So with individual interviewees, I can't pay them obviously, but I am ensuring that there's some kind of benefit. So as I get more data put together and synthesize it, it's just sharing it back with them. There are a couple people who I've already written reviews of or gone to their gigs as like a thank you. And then on a broader level, currently I am assisting he is a Lewisham resident and just a colleague of mine from school. He is putting together a company that is a community interest company looking to reopen a community center for local uses. And so I've been assisting him with the logistics of that. And then beyond that, because I'm already tapping into my existing like social and music network, fortunately I'm developing more of that. And so I have a couple more years left on this. And so it is a thing that weighs heavily on my mind, but I think that I will need more time to figure out the best and the most appropriate way to disseminate it. But it is something I take very seriously and is constantly on the brain. So.
Thank you, Christine. I'm afraid there's no break for you. A question, a proposal from Julian, Professor Julian Henriquez. First of all, the comment. I hope you include Goldsmiths, which is the home of Sound System International, in your research. Our management, and underlined is not staff or students, want to be a player in this gentrification process, which is its planned enterprise hub and its new civic university strategy. Yeah. Just to say, Julian would be very happy to talk to you about more about this. So if you link him after today, that'd be great.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Great. So my next question is from Andreas to Njelle. We would barely hear your presentation. I will surely check out your work online. But I just wanted to ask you if you could expand on the fascinating concept of sound system. Thank you. Over to you, Njelle.
Thank you. I hope this stays on long enough for me to answer. So thanks for that question. And so sound system the term comes from Marcia Douglas's novel, The Marvelous Equation of Dread, and she uses it, you know, it's she has these musical annotations below each chapter or track of the novel. And among them, the recurring terms is sound sistrine. One is background sound sistrine and the other is sound sistrine. And she's using it partly to think about the question I asked, you know, where are women in the history and the contemporary practices of sound system culture? And so what does it mean for women to use their voices and use their bodies to amplify sound, to receive and amplify sound, partly because they don't have access to the technologies. Right. You know, we've heard so much about what it takes to even build a system, you know, and so I think it's a question of access. So both race, class and access. Right. And so nevertheless, in the time travel sci-fi novels I'm looking at in this project, I'm really interested in how particular women writers move away from the kind of hyper technological and kind of machinic modes of travel and memory and focus on the body. And so I think sound sistrine is capturing for us a feminist / womanist, certainly Caribbean, Afro folk version, right? So with the body, with the locks, with the voice, these women are actually getting at similar kinds of mnemonic and revolutionary work that the men typically would be able to do. And so I see Jennifer Stover's question, if I could, June, really quickly fold it in, because she's asking about women selecting practice in the record collections. So in Tentacle, Rita Indian's Tentacle, this is the one exception I've found where you have a DJ, a female DJ, who has access to, she has a turntable, she has a stack of records, you know, and she's able to kind of get a friend to install a sound system for her to play and broadcast. And so I'm thinking about race. So Elizabeth Mendes in that novel is white identifying Dominican. So there's race, class, and all of those kind of influencing who gets to use, right, actual technologies, who gets to own, you know, a stack of vinyl to play versus who has to use their voice. And so I'm really interested in kind of those distinctions as we go through some of these texts. And so, yeah, so I'm looking at, this is from a chapter on frequency. It focuses particularly on Marcia Douglas and Rita Indiana's novels.
Thank you, Njelle. Appreciate that. Next question is from Jean-Christophe Sivan to Christine. I hope you don't lose your voice, Christine. Is illusion representative of a general process or a particular case? Or put another way, are there still areas where this type of musical culture remains protected?
So unfortunately, in London, I think I could have picked any borough in London and found a similar situation. And I think, like a previous comment said, you know, this is so common in North American cities too. In terms of areas being protected, so the Greater London Authority, in response to like 30% of its grassroots venues closing in between like 2007 and 2015, had a big kerfuffle and created a music venue task force that put out how to prevent venues from closing. And a lot of it focuses on licensing and new developments, not making noise complaints about existing things. But in terms of like concerted efforts, I don't know. And I think that one of the reasons why they're not well publicized is because I think in order for these things to be successful, it has to be an extremely local thing. Like there aren't necessarily outsiders getting involved. I think in terms of preserving culture, it would be most productive to focus on preserving residential networks and not starting at culture and just looking at who is here and how can we keep them here. If that answers your question.
Thank you, Christine. So our next question is from Melville, Melville Cook from Anonymous. Thanks for this insight into Jamaica or Jamaican public discourse. I remember you also wrote about a phone company using reggae visuals or slang to brand its campaign. What's your general opinion of corporations using reggae to appeal to a JA audience and building their brand? Over to you, Melville. Good question, I think.
Yes, thank you for the question. All right, so one of the things that we have to recognize is that the utilization of Jamaican pop, reggae and dancehall primarily for communication by corporate brands, it's incessant, okay? However, I'm making a distinction here between communication, advertising and marketing, and experiential marketing. And experiential marketing may not be that popular. It is a strategy of capital's accumulation of space, right? Moving from the physical space, but moving now to the intellectual space. And by the way, in our most recent general election, there was an increased use of Jamaican popular music, doublets, sound system doublets by candidates in September 2020. Okay, so in terms of the communication and advertising jingle at doublet, I'm all for that. That's great. In terms of experiential marketing, from a personal point of view, I am not for that, because one of the requirements of experiential branding that Nicholas Caro speaks about is that it needs bland content. It needs content that is not offensive to any party. Okay, and that is going to inevitably hit the creative root of the product, no matter how you look at it. And I think that has happened with hip hop. Ken Bilby made that statement that Ken Bilby made, you know, that the one mass media that the privileged classes in Jamaica could not control was a 45 RPM record, is extremely critical. Now, utilizing the music for corporate branding increased, I think, in COVID-19, because it was about broadcast, it was about on YouTube, it was free-to-air television. However, when we look at the live stage at a Jamaican event where there's a digital backdrop, there's this huge difference between what is put on screen and what used to be a cloth backdrop that represented the ethos, the spirit of the event. Whereas we were looking at depictions of spirituality, whereas we were looking at depictions of like staying with the B on it. Now we are looking, in pre-COVID times, of course, at advertisements, at corporate branding. And for me, that makes the entertainer there seem, well, it doesn't reduce them totally to that, but it makes them in part a moving part section of an advertising installation. So there's more that could be said, but in the interest of time, but in terms of communication, the dub place, the jingles, great. In terms of experiential marketing, accumulating the ideological, the intellectual space of a music that has been created largely by lower socioeconomic class Jamaicans. Personally, I'm not for it. And although I've researched it, I may be in the minority there.
Thank you very much, Melville. I think I had a question for Micheal McMillan, so I'm inviting him to come back on screen. Yeah, it's from Nadia to Micheal. Thanks, Micheal, for coming back. Nadia says, I've really enjoyed your focus in the anthology on the sound, Her Story, made by women sound practitioners. Do you think they paved the way for today's women MCs like Miss Banks, Shabo, or Little Sims?
Oh, most definitely, Nadia. I mean, in a sense, generationally, and I have to apologize to Thali Lotus for not including her in the anthology, but the editors put a limit, you know. And I was focusing on generationally, my generation. So that includes June, you know, in Zynga, Sister Culture, you know, the like, because they are the pioneers, really, that a lot of females agency within sound system kind of comes into being. And so, you know, that emerged organically because the anthology was developed during the pandemic. And the man them never respond, but the women did. So I went with the women. And how beautiful and wonderful that has been, really, that the women have responded. And it sheer says something about kind of, you know, kind of the agency, but also the commitment that these women, sound women, have shown. I also wanted to mention, in terms of being inclusive, there is another sound that's emerged called BOSS, Black Obsidian Sound System, which is a Black Queer sound system. You know, so in the anthology, we won't even necessarily include them, but I will mention them, because it's, for me, it's about being inclusive, because women and queer people have always been involved in sound system. They just haven't been represented as such. So it's bringing that into being.
Thank you, Michael. I'm going to try and get through as many questions in the next 5 minutes, because I wanted to draw your attention to what's coming to tomorrow and what's coming later on after we finish this session. And I do need to finish at six. I will talk to the organizer about how we respond to the unanswered questions, maybe via our own website. So the next question is from Anonymous to Thali. Thali, I'm going to really ask you to be as concise as possible. I apologize for the pressure. Could you speak a bit more about the accessibility of the mic you described? Is it accessible price-wise, easy to build as DIY, or change according to the operator's needs? Please answer as you can, Thali, but be concise for me. And I think it's from, thank you.
Okay, so yes would be the most concise version. Yes, it is. It is accessible price-wise. You know, in terms of affordability, I definitely think it's on par with, you know, the main competitors in that range. So yes, I think it's definitely going to be accessible. And obviously, considering the socioeconomic and demographic of where I'm coming from, and the fact that Come As You Are is about, you know, getting everybody to be heard and, you know, voices to be heard. So yeah, that's been a consideration. I don't know what she means easy to build as DIY in terms of me creating it. It's been a very long journey, and I do have a engineer and a designer that I'm working with. And obviously the mic is available in four different variations. So it's available in Bluetooth as well as XLR connections. And then it's also available in MEMS and also electric. So yes, I think it will be accessible for various uses and people.
Thanks, Thali. Thank you for being accommodating there. Njelle, there are two questions, and I'm going to try and combine them and ask you to answer them as best you can, but in a concise way. So the first question, I'm not sure who it's from, but it says, can you briefly tell us about the most important novel you drew from in your research? Have you also looked into British Caribbean feminine literature? And then the second question was really asking you about selecting. Does that show up in any of your literary expressions, a representation of sound systems? And how might we understand selecting as a temporal practice? You may have to omit a response to part of that, those questions, but I'll hand over to you, Njelle. Do we still have Njelle in the house?
No worries. Thanks, Jude. Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can. Thank you, sis. Forward, yeah?
All right, so so my current book project is mostly, it's actually exclusively about Caribbean time travel novels. I'm focusing on time and time travel and time machines in particular, so that kind of limits me. So I'm not only writing about women writers, but I'm really interested in sort of the sonorities that I notice in some of these novels. As I mentioned, for that chapter on frequency, Marcia Douglas, Rita Indiana, there's also Wilson Harris, and this ridiculously amazing novel by Luis Otoniel Rosa called Done with Gargamel from a Spanish translation. So those are the ones I'm working on for this chapter on. I'm calling it string theory. It's thinking about, somebody was asking about frequency. It's thinking about the frequencies. So when you strum a guitar string or a lock or a thread, as these characters do, at different, you know, different parts of the chord or the string, how does that change what is audible? And so thinking about memory work, you know, so there's at the top end of the mids of a song, what is audible there and what is not audible, what is below even the bass, And these novels suggest that that's where memory, that's where at least root memories, Black memories, are housed because of the suppression, because of, you know, the anti-Black noise laws that we kind of see continuing down through time. And so that's kind of a general theme I'm noticing across the text, right? That we're thinking about frequencies, not the ones that are kind of normally audible, but what is not audible. So in Indiana's Tentacle, she's not just selecting music to entertain, even though she does want to entertain. She's mixing, she's selecting particular mixes, particular samples in order. And I created a whole mix for you guys trying to sonify the novel, that moment in the novel, because I wanted to hear the kinds of things she puts together, the temporalities of disparate times, disparate genres that she puts together. And then the new meanings, the subterranean meanings that she's able to elicit, right, by the particular combination of samples and sounds and genres, that when you listen to the song itself or you listen to the top and mids, you won't hear that, right? And so the ways that part of the role of the amplifier or the selector, these women in these novels, is that they allow us, at least they create conditions for us to hear things and to remember things that we don't actually get in even most revolutionary music, right? Part of the question in these novels is, even when I make you hear, will you actually listen? And so even deaf characters in these novels receive inaudible, but the men, for instance.
Njelle, I'm going to have to stop you there. Thank you. So our last question is from H. Patton. I need to say Dr. H. Patton, Mr. Melville. Melville, I'm going to have to give you just over a minute to respond, because I need to just close with some notifications to our guest today. Thank you for your presentation, Melville. Can you say something about the appropriation of African poor people's cultural expression as a mode of engaging people through the lens of cool, but not benefiting them? Thank you much for that question.
And thank you as well. And thank you for introducing that matter of cool, referencing perhaps the merchants of cool, which I should have before. I'm not sure. Okay, so when these campaigns are run and individual entertainers are hired to be representatives, brand ambassadors, or to do jingles, or are hired to do performances that put them in a position where they're against a backdrop of corporate branding, they are paid. So how I'm looking at it now is that it is not appropriation without some sort of payment, but it goes to a specific, very small set of persons, performers, who command the attention of the wider audience. Where the damage would come in is that notion of control, matter of the product that is presented on a stage that is big, bright, bold, and beautiful in channels that perhaps those at a lower economic level in the society who are creating cannot afford to, they cannot access to present themselves in that very attractive way to a wider audience.
Thank you, Melville. That was really succinct. Thank you so much. So before I close, first of all, I'd like to give a huge, huge thanks to all our panelists. You've been brilliant and your papers have been very insightful. I've learned a lot. I also just wanted to thank all our guests. Please don't leave. I've got a few, very few points to raise. So looking forward to our final day, which is tomorrow. We will be hosting our closing session entitled From the Rockers Sound Station to the Kingston Dub Club, where Gabriel Selassie will be in conversation with David Katz, followed by an exclusive Kingston Dub Club session from Kingston, Jamaica, as a special tribute to the late Augustus Pablo. And also to say, please stay with us, because later on today are a couple of other sessions. Firstly, we will have the exclusive performance of Conscious Way Outernational sound system from Guadeloupe, not to be missed, which will be premiered on our YouTube channel at the top of the hour, so in the next few seconds. Also, we will have Conscious Way Outernational. So I've just mentioned that, who are Unity in Diversity. Alternatively, you might still be on time to sign up for Lynette Kamala's interactive workshop entitled Recipe for a Happy Mind, which will start at 6:30. I think we had a couple places left a couple of hours ago, so check if there are any available places on the Sound System Outernational's event page. So once again, I'd like to thank all our panelists, wonderful, wonderful presentations, and to you, our guests. And I hope you stay with us tonight, and it's equally importantly that you join us tomorrow. One love, blessings, and respect.
Thank you, June.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.